As the time is near that he will come to take the ones who truly love him. Are you one of them, or do you love your sins more than him? Do you love your sins more than him, oh my friend? Do you love your sins?
Today to preach to you the Word of God. Jesus Christ said, go and sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. The Bible makes it clear that God commands you to stop sinning, to not be a sinner at all. In fact, the Bible says, as obedient children, not conforming yourself to your former lusts, as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, so you also be holy in all your conduct. For it is written, be holy, for I am holy. God commands you to be holy. If you call yourself a Christian, but you're living in sin, you're in great danger. You're in great danger. The Bible says, now by this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He that says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. 1 John 1:5-7. This is the message we have heard from him and declare unto you. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. There's lots of lies going around in American Christianity today. One of the biggest lies is that you can be a sinner and be a Christian at the same time. Impossible. As the Bible says, by this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He that says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Jesus even said himself in John 14:15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Again in John 14:21, Jesus said, he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. God commands you to love him and obey him. If you think you can be a Christian and sin every single day, you're deluded. You're delusional. You need to obey God. You need to follow Jesus Christ. In 1 John 2:15, it says, do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of this world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. The Bible says, adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore is a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself in the sight of God and he will lift you up. You need to humble yourself. You need to forsake your sins Don't be sinners. Many people think, well, if I just ask Jesus into my heart, if I pray the sinner's prayer, then I'm going to be okay with God. God accepts me. The Bible never says such a thing. Jesus never commands you to ask him into your heart. The Bible never says to pray a sinner's prayer. The Bible says to forsake your sins and follow Jesus. Isaiah 55, 6 through 7 says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Acts 3:19 doesn't say anything about a sinner's prayer. It says, repent therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing might come from the presence of the Lord. You need Jesus Christ. If you claim to be a Christian, but you're disobeying Jesus Christ, you are deluding yourself. You need to obey Jesus Christ. Some may say, well, I have the grace of God. I'm saved by grace through faith. That's true. A Christian is saved by grace through faith. But what does grace teach us? Grace teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. That's what the grace of God teaches us. Grace is not a license to sin. The Bible talks about how where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. But just because that is true, does that mean we should continue in sin? By no means, the Bible says. And the Bible says, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin, for he who has died has been freed from sin. See, Christ died to set you free from sin. Christ came to destroy the works of the devil in your life. He wants you to be holy. And Jesus said in John chapter 8, he that commits sin is a slave to sin, and a slave will not abide in the house forever, but he who the Son sets free is free indeed. Christ can set you free. Christ can cleanse you of all your sins. The Bible says, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red like crimson, they shall be as wool, if you are willing and obedient. But even before that, in Isaiah 1, it says, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, cease to do evil, learn to do good. The Bible says. That's what you need to do. You need to wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, cease to do evil, learn to do good. Come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool, if you are willing and obedient. The Bible says there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom must give an account. Friends, don't think if you have hidden private sin that no one else knows about, that God doesn't know about it. God knows about all of your sins. And he commands you to stop your sinning. He commands you to go and sin no more. He commands you to repent or perish. And we don't want you to perish. He wants you to repent. He wants you to get right with God. If you're not, you need to get right with God. Some people here may think, well, I go to a church building on Sunday. I'm a part of a youth group. I go to a church building on Wednesday. That does not make you a Christian. A Christian is someone who follows Jesus Christ. Going to a meeting on Sunday and Wednesday instead of a building that has a cross on top of it or a steeple on top of it does not make you a Christian. You don't follow and obey Jesus Christ. That's what a Christian is. Someone who follows Jesus and obeys Jesus. And I have good reason to believe there's a lot of people here who aren't doing that. Jesus talks about this in Matthew 15. People draw near to me with their mouth and praise me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Don't be one of those people, friends, who praises Jesus with their lips and with their mouth, but their heart is far from him. Don't be, you know, Jesus said that when that day comes, many will say to him, did I not do this and that and this in your name? It might be, didn't I get baptized in your name, Jesus? Didn't I go to church in your name and read my Bible in your name? He'll say, away from me, you evildoers, I never knew you. One of the most dangerous things in life is self-delusion. To think you're on your way to the kingdom of God, to think you're okay with God and right with God, but actually not be right with God. And Jesus said two things about these people. They didn't know him, and they were workers of lawlessness, workers of iniquity. So is that you? Do you actually know Jesus? Do you have an intimate, personal relationship with Jesus? Do you spend time with Jesus in the Word and in prayer? Or you just know about Jesus? There's a big difference, friends. And also, they were workers of lawlessness, workers of iniquity. They were working sin. Is that you? Are you a worker of sin but yet claim to be a Christian? If you're a worker of sin and yet claim to be a Christian, you're deceived. You're not a Christian. You don't obey God. Christians obey God. The Bible says the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal. The Lord knows who are his. Let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. You see, when you live in sin and profess to be a Christian, you're not fooling God. God is not fooled. You may fool your youth pastor, you may fool your pastor, you may fool your parents, you may fool your brothers and sisters, you may fool your friends, you may fool your spouse, you may fool the people who go to the same church as you, but you're not fooling God. And you need to be serious about your faith and to give up all of your sins. The Bible says, do not be deceived. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Do not be deceived. You know why Paul wrote that under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit? Because there are people who are deceived. And he knew there'd be people in their future who would be deceived as well, thinking they can be unrighteous and still inherit the kingdom of God. The Bible says, do not be deceived. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Here's a very important question for you, friends. Are you on that list I just named off? Are you a fornicator? Are you having sexual activity outside of marriage? Are you an idolater? Are you worshiping another god besides the God of the Bible? And now, how do you know whether you're worshiping the God of the Bible or not? Well, you have to read the Bible. You can't just go by what your pastor tells you or your youth pastor tells you. The Bible says there'll be false teachers in the last days, deceiving people. There'll be wolves in sheep's clothing. And so you have to read the Bible for yourselves. The only way you can know you're actually worshiping the right God or not is to read God's Word, which tells you about God. It tells you about yourself. Tells you what happened in the past. Tells you what will happen in the future, which is very important for you to understand. And so if you're an idolater, if you worship a God that says, oh, God doesn't judge people, you're an idolater. That's not the God of the Bible. If you say, well, my God would never send people to hell, that's not the God of the Bible. You're an idolater. If you say, well, my God is okay with me being a sinner and I'm still a Christian, you're an idolater. That's not the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible is holy and expects you to be holy as he is holy. If you say, well, my God created people and they were born homosexuals, that's not the God of the Bible. That's not what the Bible says. You're an idolater. You need to repent. So we've talked about fornicators. And what I mean by fornicator is anyone having any kind of sexual activity outside of marriage. If you're fooling around with your boyfriend or girlfriend, doing things with them that only married people should do, then you're a fornicator. Sexually immoral people will not inherit the kingdom of God. And as a former youth pastor, I know for a fact that this kind of stuff goes on in youth groups all around America. I hope it doesn't in yours, but it goes around all around America. People think it's okay to be sexually immoral with a boyfriend or girlfriend, and they're okay with God. Not true. Not true. Don't be deceived. Fornicators will not inherit the kingdom of God. You need to repent. You need to get right with God. So we have fornicators, and we have idolaters. Now we have adulterers. Now Jesus, you know, usually adulterer means someone who's married and have sex outside of their marriage. But Jesus extended that definition in Matthew 5:28. He said, if you look upon a woman to lust after her, you've committed adultery already in your heart with that woman. So my question is, young men and women, are you lusting after people in your heart? If you are, God calls you an adulterer at heart. God calls you an adulterer at heart. And remember, adulterers will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the good news is a solution to your adultery. Matthew 5:29-30, Jesus gives a solution. He says, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It'd be better for you to enter into life maimed with one eye than to go to hell with both of your eyes. If your hand calls you to sin, all you porn watchers, click, click, click on the internet porn. If your hand calls you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It's better for you to enter into life with one hand than to go to hell with both of your hands. Those of you who, your feet are causing you to sin, you're walking to your girlfriend's house and your boyfriend's house to lust with them, to kiss them and fondle them. The bottom of your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It's better you enter into life with one foot than to go to hell with both of your feet. There's the answer, repentance. And Jesus is not endorsing literal mutilation here. He's simply saying, take drastic measures, do whatever it takes to get the sin out of your life, because it will cost you your very soul. The Bible says, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and then loses his soul in the end? It will not profit you, friends, if even if you could gain the whole world, which you will not, even if you could, it would not profit you to lose your soul. Your soul should be more precious to you than all the world put together. God put a value upon your soul, a very good value. He said that he sent his son to die on the cross for you.
Who told you I'd come up here and talk?
I don't have to. I don't need permission. I need permission to come up here.
Yes, you do.
I've talked to the head of security, ma'am.
Who's that? That's why I asked.
Well, my friend taught me. He's up there around the corner. You
Who's
can talk
that?
To him.
What's the name?
I don't remember his name, ma'am. I didn't
Who's
talk to him.
Name?
Well, I'm not going to stop. I'm going to keep on preaching. Yeah, so God commands you to repent, but God put a value upon your soul by sending his only begotten son to die on the cross for you. And he died on the cross not to keep you in your sin, but to deliver you from your sin. And many of you, day in and day out, engage in the very things that God sent his son to die for you, to deliver you from. That's what he did. He sent his son to deliver you from these sins, and you continue in them day in and day out. Now, what would you think about someone whose father risked their life to save them from a certain crime? Let's say it was a young man who was a pyromaniac. He loved to play with fire. And one day, it got out of control. He's playing with fire in his own house. His house caught on fire, and he had no way out. And then his own father ran into the house, saved him, and as he looked back at his father in the house, his father burned alive in the house. Now, what would you think about that son if he continued to be a pyromaniac even after his father risked his own life, laid down his own life to save him from his own sins, own wickedness, pyromania? What would you think of that son? You'd think he was ungrateful. You'd think he was unthankful. You'd think he didn't esteem the sacrifice of his father. That he didn't care about his father's sacrifice, giving up his life for him. And that's what a professing Christian is like, who knows that Christ died on the cross to deliver them from sin, and yet they continue in sin anyway. You don't esteem the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. You don't care. You're like the people that Hebrews 10 talked about. They trample the blood of Christ underfoot and they don't esteem his sacrifice. They don't esteem the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. But the fact is, Christ died to deliver you from sin. As 2 Corinthians 5:15 says, and he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. See, Christ died for all of you. That's true. But the benefits of his sacrifice are only good for those who actually turn from living for themselves and turn to living for God. Yes, he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Now tell me, friends, are you living for Jesus Christ? Be honest with yourself. Are you truly living for Jesus Christ? If you're sinning every single day, you couldn't possibly answer that question honestly with a yes. All you can say is no. And hopefully you'd say no with a humble and contrite heart, realizing your situation, realizing your estate, realizing you're in danger. Yes, a fire truck comes in, honks its horn. You see police sirens, you move out of the way. You hear sirens like that, you know there's trouble somewhere, or potential trouble. And I'm here to be a siren to you to know there's potential trouble for some of you who are living in your sin still. Even if you're professing to be a Christian, you're still living in sin, you're in trouble. Let's go back to our list. We went through fornicators are not going to the kingdom of God, they're going to hell. So are idolaters, so are adulterers. And then there's homosexuals and sodomites. Now, unfortunately, Christianity has gotten so bad in America that some so-called churches say, well, they're born that way, we must accept them the way they are. Well, the Bible says, and makes it very clear, in no uncertain terms, that homosexuals and sodomites are on their way to hell. You need to understand that. If you're thinking about becoming a homosexual or a sodomite or a lesbian, if you're considering it, maybe there's people who are flirting with you from the same gender as you, you need to realize that is not God's will for you. You were not born that way. The Bible calls it in Romans 1, unnatural, shameful, vile. That's what the Bible calls it. And Leviticus is called an abomination before God. If you're considering becoming a homosexual or a lesbian, or you already are practicing such things, you need to realize, don't be deceived, you weren't born that way. It's not God's will for you to be that way. God commands you to repent. God tells you that's unnatural and shameful and vile and an abomination. And you need to repent. God can forgive you. God can cleanse you, but you need to repent. If you don't repent, you're going to be in trouble. Get right with God. Next on the list of 1 Corinthians 6, 9, and 10 is drunkards. It's probably actually, I think covetous is next, but we'll go to drunkards first. If you are professing to be a Christian out here tonight, and you like to get buzzed, or tipsy, or drunk on beer or wine, don't be deceived. You are unrighteous. You are not on your way to the kingdom of God. You are on your way to hell. You need to repent. Drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God. Drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's not God's will for you to be drunk. It's God's will for you to be filled with the Spirit. It's God's will for you to have self-control. It's God's will for you to have a sound mind, not a drunken mind. That's God's will for you. So if you're getting drunk or have gotten drunk, you need to repent. Get right with God while you still have time. You may not have another day to get right with God. This could be your last day. Don't think because you're going to a supposed Christian concert that makes you a Christian. Don't think because you're going to a supposed Christian concert that makes you okay with God. not true. You need to follow Jesus Christ and obey him yourself. There'll be no piggybacking into God's kingdom. You won't be able to ride on your parents' back or your grandparents' back or youth pastors' back into the kingdom of God. You need to follow Jesus Christ yourself. You need to obey him yourself. That's what you must do. Ephesians 5, verses 5 through 7 says, "For this you know, that no fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience." Yeah, I know you loudmouth women can't stand the preaching of God's word. I understand. You know, if you truly are a Christian here today, you would be rejoicing in God's word being preached. You wouldn't be telling me to shut up or be quiet. You wouldn't be spewing out your wrath from your mouth. You'd be rejoicing that the word of God has been preached. And if your unsaved friends are here with you, as some kind of supposed outreach, you'd be praising God that they're hearing the truth of God's word. You know, many professing Christians don't understand the teaching of the fear of God. Most professing Christians think, well, I don't have to fear God. That's not true. The Bible says, "Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil." God is going to bring your secret things into judgment. You need to fear God and keep his commandments. Some of you may be a part of a purpose-driven church. You want a purpose in life? Here it is. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. That's what God wants you to do. That's God's will for you, to fear him and keep his commandments. The Bible says in mercy and truth, atonement was provided for iniquity, and by the fear of the Lord one departs from evil. You know what we need more of in this world? More fear of God, more fear of hell. So we need more of it. If we had more fear of God in this world, we have less sin. If you feared God, you wouldn't sin. If you feared God, you wouldn't dress the way you dress. If you feared God, you wouldn't be a sinner. Because those who fear God depart from iniquity. Those who fear God wouldn't dare dress immodestly. They wouldn't dare dress with tight clothing on that reveals all the curves of their body. You know, the Bible says that a godly woman will dress modestly. A godly woman will dress modestly. And if your clothes are so tight, either they're covering all your body, but they're so tight, it's like another layer of skin revealing every curve of your body, you are not dressing modestly. And a godly woman will dress modestly. Yes, if you're not dressed modestly, you're not a godly woman. You need to dress more and more loose clothing. Clothing that covers your body and doesn't reveal all the curves of your body. Those are the kind of things only your husband should see. Not everybody who walks around and wants to lust after you. But if you feared God, if you truly feared God, you wouldn't be a sinner. You wouldn't lust. You wouldn't get drunk. You wouldn't covet. I wonder how many here today have coveted today. They've looked upon something and said, "I want that. I gotta have that." That's covetousness. And the Bible says that the covetous will not inherit the kingdom of God. And in Ephesians 5, 5 through 7, the covetous are called idolaters. Because those who are covetous, they They treat the thing they want as if it is God. It's that important to them. But the covetous will not inherit the kingdom of God. I wonder how many here today spend hours and hours and hours playing video games. Maybe even violent video games. And the Bible says, see then that you walk carefully, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, for the days are evil. If you're sitting around playing video games all day, even if they aren't violent, you are the very definition of not walking carefully. You're the very definition of not redeeming the time, but of wasting your time. But the Bible commands you to walk carefully, walk circumspectly, redeeming the time, for the days are evil. Do not walk as fools, but as wise. Redeeming the time, saving the time, using it wisely, for the days are evil. You know, in the last days, the Bible says, the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. There's lots of doctrines of demons in American Christianity. Lots of them. One of those doctrines of demons is that we have to sin and we can't stop sinning. Well, it's not true. God commands you to stop sinning. In fact, long before the New Testament, long before the cross, long before the Holy Spirit indwelt believers, there was a man named Noah. In Genesis 6:9, God says, this is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God. That's what God said about Noah, who lived before the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, before the cross of Calvary, before the New Testament. He obeyed God. He obeyed God. And that's what you ought to do if you say you love Christ. If you say you love God. Don't give into this doctrine of demons that don't sear your conscience, that speaks lies to you, says, well, I can't live holy. We've all sinned to come short of the glory of God. If you are here with your boyfriend or girlfriend, you're touching and groping all over them, you're in danger. You're already given in to lust. You've already given yourself over to lust. And the lustful, the adulterers at heart, will not inherit the kingdom of God. And if you're a youth pastor over a youth group, and you're allowing those things to happen, you're in great danger too. You're deceived and deluded yourself. If you're a shepherd of the flock, you shouldn't be feeding them to wolves. You shouldn't be letting them go astray like that. I'd be willing to bet that most people here today know John 3:16 by heart. But I wonder how many read on past that. I wonder how many have read to John 3:18 and John 3:19. Let me read it to you, in case you have never read it before yourself. So most of us know John 3:16, which says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I wonder how many read John 3:18 and John 3:19. He who believes in him is not condemned. He who does not believe is condemned already. He has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. Is that you? Do you love darkness rather than light? Do you love to watch filthy movies with cuss words and blasphemy and sex scenes in them and violence? Well, then you're on your way to hell. You need to repent. You need to forsake your sins. Not a funny thing, young man, to be on the way to hell. It's not a funny thing to love sin, the things that God hates. He sent his Son to die for those things. and you love those things and engage in those things? But do you love darkness rather than light? Well, look at your life. Examine your heart. How much of your life is spent on sin and appealing to the pleasure of the lust of your flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life? And how much of your life is spent for the glory of God? How much of your life is taking up your cross daily, denying yourself, and following Jesus? And I'll tell you this, if you're following Jesus, you're not going to be sinning. Because Jesus Christ would never lead you to sin, that's for sure. He's a sinless Savior. He's a holy Savior, not a sinful Savior. And if you're following Jesus Christ, He will lead you to holiness. He will lead you to everlasting life. He will lead you through the narrow gate and down the difficult path. But if you're living in sin each day, you're not following Jesus Christ. You need to obey Jesus Christ. That's what He commands you to do. I know you sinners don't like God's word being preached. Yeah, well, take a hold of this love. Revelation 3:19, Jesus said, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent." The question is not whether God loves you. The question is, do you love God? If you love God, you will obey God. You're not my brother if you're a sinner, and I'm not a sinner. I'm a saint. I am not a sinner.
Read your Bible. You're sinning right now.
Why are you so angry, sinner? Why are you so angry? Why are you so angry? Says who? Says who? I've been quoting the Bible, young man. You don't know your Bible. Come on, what? I know my Bible. Take a hold of this thing, man. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3 through 4 says this. Now by this we know that we know him. Why are you running away, young man? Now by this we know that we know him. If we keep his commandments. He who says I know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Read your Bible, young man. Read your Bible. If you know God, you will obey God. If you claim to know God, but you don't obey God, you're a liar. And the truth is not in you. If you truly are a Christian here today, you would rejoice in the preaching of God's word. If you are truly a Christian today, you wouldn't say, well, I'm a sinner. Christians live holy. Christians are not sinners. When Paul was writing in the New Testament, he commonly wrote to the saints in the city he was writing to. He commonly wrote to the saints in Ephesus, or the saints in Corinth, those who are following God. And if you're not a saint of God, and a saint means holy one, if you're not a saint of God, then you're a sinner and you're in great danger. Sinners will not inherit the kingdom of God. Sinners will end up in hell in the end. That's not what we want for you, but it's what will end up happening to you if you don't repent, if you don't get right with God. That's what's going to happen to you. So, the Bible says, no, I'm not going to shut up, sinner. The Bible says in James 2:19, you believe that there is one God, you do well. Even demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, oh foolish man, that faith without works is dead?
Appreciate you, brother.
Amen. Faith without works is dead. You claim to believe in Jesus, but do you actually obey Jesus? Do you follow Jesus? Or are you sinning every day in thought, word, and deed? Because faith without works is dead. As the body without the soul is dead, so faith without works is dead. Do you have a working faith, or you have an intellectual, mental faith, and that's it? See, knowing about Jesus isn't enough, friends. You must actually know Jesus. John 17:3 says, this is eternal life, knowing God the Father and the one He has sent. Eternal life is not praying a prayer one time in the past and living like the way you want the rest of your life. Eternal Eternal life is not going to a building every Sunday. Eternal life is knowing God the Father and the one he has sent. Do you know them? Do you truly know God the Father and Jesus Christ? Or are you just living in sin every single day? The Bible says, if you walk according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. And as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. If you truly are led by the Spirit of God, you will not be in sin. You'll be living a holy life. And the Spirit of God would never lead you to sin. The Spirit of God always leads you to righteousness. Because he's a holy spirit. Not a sinful spirit, but a holy spirit. If you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you, you're not going to be sinning. You're going to be following Jesus Christ, obeying Jesus Christ. Not going to be lusting and fornicating and getting drunk and being a liar to your parents and being covetous. Because every liar shall have his part in the lake of fire. But the Bible says, every liar shall have his part in the lake of fire. The Bible said in Revelation 22:14, blessed are those who do the commandments of God, that they might have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. But outside the city are the dogs, the sorcerers, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices a lie. I wonder how many youth here today would say, I hate that guy at school. I hate that girl at school. And the Bible says, hatred is murder of the heart. And the Bible says, murderers will not inherit the kingdom of God. You need to repent of that if that's you. But everyone who loves and practices lies will not enter the city. The holy city will not take part in the tree of life. And Revelation 21 says they will have their part in the lake of fire. Are you a liar, friends? Do you lie to your parents? Do you lie to your friends? Do you lie to your teachers? If so, you're in great danger. You need to repent of lying. You need to forsake your lying. You need to follow Jesus Christ. Many people live a lie. Their whole life's a lie. They claim to be a Christian, but they have secret sin. They claim to be a Christian, but they're living in sin each and every day. And they're in great danger. The Bible calls that a hypocrite. And Christ has some strong words for hypocrites. He said, woe to you, hypocrites! You're like a whitewashed tomb full of dead man's bones.
Ain't nobody got time for that!
You don't have time for the Word of God, sinner? Well, I pity you then. I pity you if you don't have time for the Word of God. If you don't have time for the Word of God, don't call yourself a Christian, that's for sure. Because you're not one. And you're deceiving yourself if you think you are one if you don't have time for the very words of God written to you for your own edification. 2 Timothy 3:5 says, having a form of godliness, but denying its power, from such people turn away. Having a form of godliness, but denying its power, from such people, turn away. Many of you here today, that verse directly applies to you. You have a form of godliness. You would call yourself a Christian. You might have a Jesus fish on your car. You might have a cross around your neck. You may have a Bible with your name engraved on it. You may have a card inside that Bible that tells people when you prayed the sinner's prayer. You may have been baptized in water. But you deny the power of God, and the godliness you have is only a form of it. Not true godliness, but a form of it. And the Bible said if you're that kind of person that is a form of godliness, but denies the power of it, that you're to turn away from it. That you're to turn away from it. Titus 1:16 says something very similar. It says, they profess to know God, but in works deny him, being abominable disobedient, and disqualified for every good work. They profess to know God, but in works deny Him, being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good work. Is that you? Do you profess to know God, but in your works you deny Him? Do you claim to be a Christian but are fornicating with your boyfriend or girlfriend? Do you claim to be a Christian but are watching pornography on the internet? Do you claim to be a Christian but you spend every extra hour you have playing video games or sports? Do you claim to be a Christian but your Bible has so much dust on it you can write the word damned in the dust? Do you claim to be a Christian but you sin every single day in thought, word, and deed? Do you claim to be a Christian, yet you lie to your parents and covet and covet and covet, especially around your birthday and Christmas? The Bible makes it clear that sinners will not inherit God's kingdom. You need to repent while you still have time. The Bible says your life is but a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. You could die today, friends, and then your judgment is sealed. The Bible says, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of His saints to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things ungodly sinners have spoken against them. See, Christ is going to return. He's going to judge the wicked. And if you're wicked and returns, He will judge you. And you're in great danger. Because not only is Christ returning soon, you could die soon. You never know when you're going to die. People die every day who think, well, I'm not going to die today. People every day end up in the obituary section of the newspaper and didn't realize that was going to happen to them. Today could be your day. And one day, you can say that about yourself. Today will be your day. But you never know when it's going to be. And so I implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. I implore you to give up all of your sins, to follow Jesus Christ, to obey Him, to follow Him, to serve Him. And Jesus Christ said, anyone who wants to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul in the end? Or what will a man give in exchange for a soul? If you are ashamed of me and my words, as an adulterous and sinful generation, of you, the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. The Bible says that when Christ sends out his angels, they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. They'll be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Open your ears, friends. Hear the truth of God's word, that He commands you to forsake all of your sins, all of them, and follow Him with wholehearted devotion, to not be sinners anymore, to not follow false teachers anymore. If you've been told from the pulpit of your church that you have to sin every day and you're going to be a sinner to the day you die, run for your life. Run for your eternal life, because God commands you to repent. God commands you to give up all of your sins. If you've been told from the pulpit of your church, oh, nothing you can do will cost your salvation, you're once saved, always saved, run for your life. Hebrews 3:12 says, beware, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. 1 Corinthians 10:12 says, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. So the Bible says, in Romans 11, it says, consider now the goodness and the severity of God. On those who fell, severity. But toward you, goodness, if you continue in His goodness. Otherwise, you will also be cut off. So if you claim to be a Christian, if you really are a Christian, you need to beware. You need to take heed. You need to consider the goodness and severity of God. You need to continue in God's goodness. Otherwise, you'll be cut off. Don't think, friends, that because you were a Christian one time in the past, you're still one now, or that you're guaranteed to make it to the kingdom of God. Not true. The Bible is full of warnings for the believer, the genuine believer, that they might fall away from the faith. As I quoted earlier, the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. So if your pastor tells you, oh, you can't live holy in this life, the pastor tells you you can't lose your salvation, run for your life, run for your eternal life, he's lying to you. He may be just deceived himself, but he's still lying to you. You need to get right with God while you still have time.
I bet most of you out here, all you people, attention please to the guy on the mouth right here.
No, I got it.
I bet most of you out there would say you love Jesus. I bet most of you would say you love Jesus. Well, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. That's what Jesus Christ himself said. That's red letters right there. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. One of God's commandments is go and sin no more. That's in the Son of God movie. And in the Bible. You need to go and sin no more. Not go and sin some more. Not sin less, but be sinless. That's what you need to be. How can you overcome sin?
Okay.
Right here, son. How can you overcome temptation?
They can't read it from over there, Malcolm.
Through Jesus Christ.
Facing that way.
Do you know if you're a Christian that you've been born again and that God lives inside of you? If you're a Christian, the Holy Spirit lives inside of you. If you're a Christian. And the Holy Spirit is holy. The Holy Spirit's not going to lead you to sin. The Holy Spirit is going to lead you in holiness, in righteousness, in godliness, in sinlessness. That's what the Holy Spirit will do. But why do you take God, why do you take the Holy Spirit and you twist who he is and you say, no, I'm born again, but I sin every day, all the time. No, that's not true. The Holy Spirit's not living inside you if you're sinning every day. Don't be deceived. Don't just believe what your pastor says because he's the guy standing up behind the pulpit. Read the Bible. Read the Bible for yourself. Be a Berean. And the Bible says to go and sin no more. That's one of Jesus' commandments. If you love Jesus out here, you would obey Jesus. Women, you would dress modestly, not wearing tight clothes that expose every curve of your body. Men, if you loved Jesus, you wouldn't be lusting after these immodestly dressed women. You would not be committing adultery with them in your heart. If you loved Jesus, there's a lot of false teachers out there. And they think that if their church is big and they baptize 1,000 people in a year, that they're doing good. Well, guess what? If a sinner gets baptized and he hasn't been first baptized in the Holy Spirit, when he comes up out of that water, he's just a wet sinner. Have you been born again of the Holy Spirit? Jesus Christ said, you must be born again. You know you're born again when the Holy Spirit comes to live inside you, and when you change, when you turn from sin, when you repent, when you turn your life to God, for there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end of it is death. You turn from death, you turn to life, to life. You come to the light that your deeds may be exposed. That's what you would do if you're a true Christian. If you are a true Christian, that's what you would do. You would read your Bible more than you spend time on your phone. More than you spend time playing Angry Birds, you'd be reading your Bible. More than you spend time watching UK games, you'd be reading your Bible. More time reading your Bible should be spent than listening to Christian radio. If you're a true Christian, you would not mock the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you're a true Christian, you should be rejoicing that the gospel is being preached. But I don't see any of you rejoicing that the gospel is being preached. I see you just walking along to your concert, walking along thinking you're okay with God. When the Bible says that most people are on the broad path that leads to destruction. The broad path. Very few are on the narrow path that leads to life. Very few are on the narrow path that leads to life. Are you on the narrow path that leads to life? Or are you on the broad path that leads to destruction? Are you on the stairway to hell? You need to repent of your sins if you haven't. You need to be born again of the Holy Spirit. Being born again is not praying a prayer. People in every religion pray. Every religion. Even praying to Jesus doesn't make you a Christian. Jesus said many will come in that day and say, Lord, Lord. A Christian is someone who's been baptized in the Holy Spirit, who's living righteously, godly, and soberly in this present age, living soberly in this present age, not sinning and thinking you're okay and having idols in your life. You need to repent. Turn from your sin. That's what the Bible says. Turn from your sin. Turn to righteousness, to Jesus Christ. If you love Jesus, keep his commandments. You might think you're wise because you go to college or you graduated high school. You might think you're wise because you go to church. But the Bible says that the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. You need to fear God and tremble before him. Repent of your sins, of your fornication. If you're out here with your boyfriend or girlfriend, you're having sex with them.
There you go.
You're having sex with them. If you're kissing and grinding all up on your boyfriend or girlfriend, that's not Christian. That is not Christian. That is from Satan, from the devil. You're being deceived. True Christians do not fornicate. True Christians remain pure. They purify themselves. They stay clean, unspotted from this world. Do you blend in this world? Do you blend into this world? Or do you stand out? The Bible says that if you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. Are you a friend of this world? Are you friend of this world? The Bible says if you're a friend of this world, the love of the Father is not in you. Are you a friend of this world? If you are, you're in great danger. You need to repent. You know, the Bible calls Satan the ruler, the god of this world. I don't want to be friends with the world that's ruled by Satan. You need to be not of this world. You need to be a holy people. Most of you are not holy. And the Bible says that without holiness, no man or woman will see God. You need to be holy. Parents, you need to lead your children in righteousness and not in sin. You need to lead your children to righteousness. Many of you out here would call yourselves a Christian. Are you a Christian? Are you a follower of Jesus? That's what a Christian is. A Christian isn't someone who goes to church. A Christian isn't someone who gives tithe. A Christian isn't someone who listens to Christian radio. A Christian isn't someone who goes to a concert that supposedly has Christians in it. No, a Christian is a follower of Jesus, a Christ imitator. The Bible says, be holy as he is holy, as Jesus is holy. You should be waking up right now. You should wake up. But you remain in your sin, you remain blind, and because you say you see, your sin remains. Blind guides leading the blind, you'll all end up in a ditch. Repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. Have you been refreshed by the Holy Spirit? Do you have peace of God that passes all understanding? Or do you have peace of this world that lasts a short time? You need to have the peace of God. Can you say that right now, if a Muslim came and threatened to cut off your head, you would say, yes, you could cut off my head, I'm not going to deny Christ. Or would you deny Christ and save your life? The Bible says, whoever seeks to save his life will lose it. You need to pick up your cross and follow Jesus. That's Bible. Oh, yes. But like my brother said earlier, it's not whether God loves you, it's whether you love God. So do you love God? Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. You need to love Jesus. It's so sad nowadays. I see many people call themselves Christians, yet they say, oh yeah, I have sex outside marriage. Oh yeah, I lie sometimes. Oh yeah, I lust. I'm still a Christian though, it's okay. God forgave me one time when I was 4. Oh, you're deceived. You are so deceived with your NIV message Bibles. You are so deceived. You don't search out the scriptures for yourselves. You just rely on your pastors, on these men. Why do you rely on men? Rely on God. Have the Holy Spirit teach you. He should be your teacher, the Holy Spirit. That's who should be your teacher. You need to be led by the Holy Spirit. If you claim to have the Holy Spirit in you, you need to be led by Him. And the Holy Spirit's not going to lead you to sin, Christian. The Holy Spirit's going to lead you in holiness. Don't lie to me and tell me you're a Christian, and yet you sin every day. You're not led by the Spirit. You don't walk in the Spirit, but you walk in the flesh. You know, You can have victory in Jesus. You can have true victory in Jesus Christ. You can overcome temptation. Jesus Christ died on a cross. He conquered sin and death. He can give you the Holy Spirit, who has the power to overcome sin and temptation. Should we continue in grace that sin may abound? Or should we continue in
sin
that grace may abound? Certainly not. No, we shouldn't. We should not continue in sin. Submit to God. Step number one to overcoming sin. Submit to God. Don't submit to your flesh. Submit to God. Step two, resist the devil. You know how Jesus resisted the devil? He quoted scripture. That's how Jesus resisted the devil. Do you even resist the devil? Do you even submit to God? Or do you submit to the devil? Do you submit to the flesh? Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Step three, draw near to God. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. You need to seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his ways and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. God will pardon you of your sin, but you have to turn from it. Repentance is a word that's being left out of Christianity. Repentance means turning from and continuing no longer in. Do you turn from sin, continue no longer in it? You know, the Bible is a guidebook to help you not sin, to help you lead others to Christ. But you shake your head, you laugh. You don't heed God's word. You don't heed the Bible. When in it are found life, you can have true life, not this false life of the world. Just because you have cool clothes, just because you have a nice phone, a bunch of friends, that's not true life. True life and happiness and joy is found in Jesus Christ and found in abiding in him. You know, Jesus said, abide in me. That's what Jesus said. Are you abiding in Jesus or are you abiding in sin? Now here's something that most of you are going to disagree with. Most of you will disagree with my next point right here. Now, God hates evil. If you're a Christian, would you say God hates evil? Yes, God hates evil, right? Okay, well if you join yourself with evil, God still hates evil. So if you become one with evil, God still hates evil, therefore God hates you. Yes, God hates the sinners. God hates the sin, and God hates the sinners because they have joined themselves with sin. They've joined themselves with something that is against his nature. God's nature is not to take pleasure in sin. God's nature is not to love sin. God's nature is to hate sin. To take no pleasure in sin, but only take pleasure in righteousness and in holiness. So if you're taking pleasure in sin, and you're taking pleasure in wickedness, oh, you're in deep trouble because God hates the wicked. And the one who loves violence, his soul hates. God does hate. You need to open your eyes to the scripture.
Hey, Josh. About 3 more minutes, wrap it up, we're going to head out the other way, to the front.
Oh, friends, most of you would say that I'm preaching to the choir. That's what most of you would say. Oh, we're Christians, you're just preaching to the choir. Well, guess what? This choir has forgotten the lyrics. This choir has forgotten the lyrics. You have forgotten God. You have forgotten true doctrine, true holiness, true repentance, true forgiveness. You have forgotten it. That's what you have forgotten. You need to remember the scriptures. Return to your first love. Why have you forsaken your first love? Why have you turned to sin? You need to repent of your sin. Turn to God. No sinner will enter heaven. Not one sinner will be in heaven.
I love you guys.
Not one.
I love you,
not one. All the sinners will be in hell for all eternity. Think about that. Think about what your pastor is telling you. If your pastor is telling you it's okay to sin, it's okay to have fornication, sex outside marriage, it's okay to dress immodestly with clothes that are exposing your body for all the men to lust after you like you're wearing a second layer of skin. Your pastor tells you it's okay to lie. Oh, everyone lies. It's okay. It's especially okay to lie if it's for someone's good. No, that's a lie. Lies are from the devil. You need to be a Berean. Bereans were ones who searched the scriptures to see whether or not what Paul was saying is true. You need to search the scriptures for yourselves. You need to be born again. If you have not changed since you were a sinner, besides your title from unbeliever to believer, that's the only thing that's changed. You're not changed. You need to be changed from the inside out. You need to be born again. Fear God. Keep his commandments. For this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil.
How long will you rebel against him, indulging in sin? In the end it will bring damnation. Please repent and return unto him and seek him now while he may be found. Your time is running out, the clock is running down. The end of your life may be just around the next bend. Oh, please don't play games with him and seek him now while he may be found. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Keep me burning till the judgment day. It makes me sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Make me a fisher of men, keep me fishing. Make me a fisher of men, I pray. Make me a fisher of men, keep me fishing. Keep me fishing till the judgment day. It makes me sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing.
We're here at this concert that you people are going into. It's a carnal concert. Ditchfoot is leading you astray. He is a false shepherd. He's a hireling. He doesn't care about your soul. Why aren't you getting your Bibles out and reading your Bibles and obeying your Bibles? Dear, get my Bible out of my bag there, please. So God is coming to judge the world in righteousness. Are you ready for that day of judgment, friend? We don't want any of you to be condemned, but the Bible says, right here on my shirt, look at that. He who sins is of the devil. I think there's four Bible verses there. Are you living in sin? If you're living in sin, then God is condemning your life, your criminal behavior. God does not want any of us to live in sin. It is unnatural for you to live in sin, and especially to say that you love Jesus at the same time. That's hypocritical. You're pretending. You're pretenders if you're doing that. And Jesus Christ said, woe to you hypocrites. Woe to you who say you love God. Hell. Jesus Christ said, these people love me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Are you like that? Do you say you love God, but you don't obey God from the heart? Do you say you love God, but you don't obey God from the heart? That's really an important issue. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians that you need to judge yourself. Examine yourself. I'm sorry, 2 Corinthians 13:5. Judge yourselves, examine yourselves, test yourself to see if you're in the truth. But do you test yourself? Or you just keep walking down this wide road of sin, keep going to church every Sunday, living in sin, thinking you're okay? You're not okay if you're living in sin. You're a criminal if you're living in sin. You're condemned because you're living in an untoward way towards God. A corrupt way, a carnal way towards the holy God. And you say you love God. You say it, but you don't mean it. But Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commandments. And Ezekiel 59, 1 and 2, the Bible says, the arm of the Lord is not short that it cannot save, his ear not heavy that it cannot hear. But your sins, your iniquities have hidden his face from you, that he will not hear you. God chooses not to hear the prayers of sinners when you don't have a righteously broken heart about your sin and about the love of Jesus at the cross. See, that love demonstrated for you at the cross should break your heart so much, you never want to sin again. You never, ever want to sin again. Your desire is to please a holy and righteous God. That should be your desire. Yes. And if you sin, you have an advocate. Not because you have to sin every day nonsense, not because you're born in sin nonsense, but because you have the choice every day to pick up your cross and follow him, deny your sin, deny your pleasures, deny yourselves, and love Jesus. That's what you need to do. You need to love Jesus back. As Jesus Christ said, if you love me, keep my commandments. I don't need to go more than four or five verses from the Bible to reveal how ignorant Christians, so-called in America, are of what the Bible says. Do you recognize these verses that we've been preaching to you all day? Do you recognize that the Bible says without holiness, actual holiness on the inside part, from your heart, you will not see God? Not a holiness imputed to you on the outside that Jesus' blood covers you and now God the Father's blinded. That's holiness on the outward parts. But the Bible says on the inward parts, from the heart, in your spirit, that you love Jesus, and every time you're tempted, you seek the Lord Jesus and turn away from the temptation and obey. And oh, I tell you, in this day, most people say they cannot obey, and what they mean to say is, I will not obey. I will not obey you, God, to go and warn the wicked. Oh, Colossians 1:28, the Bible says, warn the wicked. Oh, if you're living in wickedness, I'm warning you. Your time is running out. You're going to be exposed on Judgment Day. God will throw you into fire. Jesus Christ said, oh, don't mock it, sir. Don't mock the truth. A wide is the road to the fire, and many go that way. Narrow is the way that leads to life, and few find it. Few. John, are you on the narrow way that leads to life, John? Are you on the narrow way? Or are you on the wide road, hireling? Hireling, are you on the wide road? Hireling, are you on the raw, wide road that leads to your destruction? Are you a false teacher leading people to destruction? Answer, yes. Ditchfoot, John, you're leading people in unrighteousness. You're leading them in a way that you think they should go. I think that's him right there. I'm not sure. In a way you think they should go, but in the end, it's their destruction. And more importantly, John, it's your destruction. The Bible says a false teacher has a stricter judgment. And if you're part of this wicked crew that's entertaining these people here today, you have a stricter judgment.
Because you will not lift up the name of Christ, you will not lift up the name of the truth, that is Jesus Christ, given to them. And on judgment day, you wish your neighbors get you out of there, but you won't have one. There'll be no salvation, no mercy for sinners on judgment day. Only judgment, John. Only judgment, man. Only judgment for sinners on judgment day. The mercy must be obtained right now. The mercy of God must be obtained right now through Jesus Christ, a broken and contrite spirit. God will not despise. Are you broken about your sin? Are you broken about the blood that Jesus shed for you? Are you broken about lost sinners going to hell? And most people are going to hell fire forever. That most of our ancestors are in fire right now.
Are they coming over here?
Oh, I'm not preaching to the choir, sister. Oh, no, I'm not. Most of the people here aren't Christians. Ditchfoot's not Christian. Lecrae's not Christian. Your definition of Christian woman is incorrect. Also, you can wave me off like that if you want. What you mean to say is you will not obey. That's the problem. Not that you cannot obey. God expects holiness on the inside part. God requires you to be holy. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, yes. There's coming a day in which an ambulance will come for you. And you'll have no comfort on that day without the seal of the Holy Spirit. And you keep grieving the Holy Spirit, and you grieve him away from you, and you die in your sin, you'll be contend for your sin. Sin is a breaking of God's law. Sin makes you a criminal against the Holy God. And God requires this. God's not begging you to come to heaven. God's commanding you to repent. He's commanding you to surrender completely to him. That's what it is, a complete surrender before you die. And none of us know when we're going to die. The Bible says it's appointed once to die and then judgment. Friends, you need to receive the mercy now. The mercy of God is shown at the blood of Jesus Christ at the cross. Oh, it's a spiritual thing. You need to respond to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit that's convicting you and convincing you of your sin even right now. Your sin is an abomination to a holy God. God wants you to come out from among them. Touch no unclean thing, the Bible says. Touch not sin. Sin is like kryptonite to the Christian. If you're living in sin, you're not a Christian. You have an unholy spirit upon you and in you. You need to repent and change your mind. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your heart, you double-minded. Repent and mourn and weep. If they would invite me in there, I'd certainly come. But they would never invite. If you can get me the stage, sir, I'm willing to come. Oh, I'd love to come do an altar call for you Christians, for you carnal Christians. I'd love to come do just 10 or 15 minutes of preaching and have you sinners shut your mouths for 10 or 15 minutes and listen to the whole truth of God's word preached, the whole thing, that you might know you're in terrible spiritual danger while you live in your sin. Stop believing these hirelings and believe the Holy Spirit and what he requires you to do. Al cielo infierno. Al cielo infierno. Oh, Jesus Christus, no solamente al cielo. Without Christ, you have no hope. Without Jesus, you have no hope. Dead in the narrow way that leads to life. God is coming to judge. Are you sure you're ready to be judged?
Yes.
It's appointed once to die and then judgment. How do you know you're ready, sir? How do you know you're ready, sir? Oh, you become a heifer against the preaching of the gospel. I get it. I get it.
Give me grace to endure. Oh, give me grace to endure, I pray. Give me grace to endure until the judgment day. It makes me sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King.
Keep me seeking you, Yahweh. Keep me seeking. Keep me seeking you, Yahweh, I pray. Keep me seeking you, Yahweh. Keep me seeking. Keep me seeking till the judgment day. It makes me sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing.